Hi, welcome back to Understanding Gradle. Today, I want to talk about defining versions for your dependencies in a central place. Let's jump right into our example. Last time, we looked at declaring dependencies. If you declare dependencies to external libraries, you need to provide a version because otherwise Gradle doesn't know which one to pick. The simplest way to do this, which you also often see, is just defining the version as part of the dependency definition. So we just add a version at the end in our build scripts directly. This is fine for very simple builds, but in larger builds, this can quickly lead to duplication and even inconsistencies. Imagine that we add this commons-lang dependency to two of our projects. Then we have repeated the version two times, and if some months later we upgrade one of the versions, we might forget about the other one, and we've created a dependency version conflict, because in the end, when we build our application, we can only use one version of the library. Gradle will resolve the conflict, and that's something we're going to talk about next time in detail, but conflicts can lead to all kinds of problems during compiling or even during runtime of your application. Because of that, it's best to avoid them in the first place if you can, especially in the components and projects you control yourself. So if we put versions in a central place, we avoid creating conflicts in our own project. I already mentioned last time that we have a central place to put build information, which is our convention plugin, by defining so-called dependency constraints with the versions we require. Dependency constraints are additional inputs to the dependency resolution mechanism of Gradle, and Gradle will use it to decide which version to take. If we haven't defined a version anywhere else, the version we see here is the version that will be picked. And since we defined the constraints in our convention plugin, we'll add them to each of our projects, so the same constraint will be used everywhere. While this solution might be fine for rather simple projects, there are also other options where you can put your dependency versions. The other build configuration we have defined in our convention plugins are quite static and we don't touch them a lot of times. For example, once we defined the Java version or decided on a test framework to use, it's unusual to change it very often. Dependency versions, however, are something that have to be touched quite a lot of time. This is due to the implications of using external libraries. There might be a lot of external factors that force you to upgrade versions, for example, security concerns. So what you usually need is some process in your team around upgrading external dependencies that is done very regularly. So for this, it might be helpful to have the versions in a different place, which is focused on dependency versions and don't mix it between your other build configuration. So there are three mechanisms in Gradle that you can use or combine for version management. The first thing I want to look at are platforms. Platforms are a collection of dependency constraints, just as we have defined them in the convention plugin. But platforms are separate projects or separate components, which we can define as a separate subproject or even in a separate build, as we will do here now. A platform is defined by applying the Java platform plugin. We do this here directly, but of course you could also have a platform convention plugin on top. Then, in the platform, you only define dependency constraints. Now this platform is like a separate component that just doesn't contain code, but only information about your dependencies. We can add a dependency to the platform in our convention plugin so that each project depends on the platform and we have the constraints available everywhere. The platform can also pull in existing platforms by depending on them. Existing platforms are also often called BOMs or bills of materials, which is a term for publishing dependency constraints in POM files in Maven repositories. One example of this is the Jackson BOM. So if you add that to your platform, you don't need to define versions for individual Jackson components, but all the versions are provided by the BOM. There are also platforms out there that provide you a consistent set of version combinations for widely used open source libraries. For example, the Spring Boot BOM. So even if you don't use Spring Boot, but want to have a good combination of versions for different libraries you're using, chances are good that these are covered by this BOM. So you could use this BOM and do not define any versions at all yourself. If you put your Java platform plugin into a separate build, as I have done here, you can also use it to define the versions of your Gradle plugins. Whether you use one platform for your production code and your plugins, or split it up into two, is up to you. Both things are not really related, but maybe you still want to have your versions consistent, so then you can put everything in one platform, as we've done here. A new feature in Gradle 7 is the dependency version catalog, about which I would like to talk now. This feature isn't stable yet, so you have to enable it in your settings Gradle file. Once it's enabled, you can put the catalog into a TOML file, which is very similar to simple properties files. The file by default is located in Gradle lib.toml. In this file, you have multiple sections to define dependencies and versions. I won't go into all the details today, but as usual, there's a link to the documentation in the GitHub page associated with this video. The most central configuration block is the libraries block, at which we'll look at now. In this block, you can define dependencies and versions. As the name says, it's the catalog, so you define dependencies with their versions, which you potentially want to use or allow to use in your project. Once you have defined things here, you can go into your build scripts and you don't need to write the coordinates down anymore. Instead, you will get an extension that corresponds to the name of the catalog, which is libs by default, and then you can access the things you defined in the catalog on this extension. This will automatically provide the coordinates of the dependencies, including the version. So here we actually define dependencies with versions, but because we pull them out of the catalog, we have a central place where all these things are defined. Now, the main difference between a catalog and a platform is that the catalog is just something local you define in your build, a bit like the convention plugins. So if we ask Gradle to show us the dependency resolution result for a runtime class pass with the two different solutions, we can see that in the case of the platform, the constraints and the platform itself turn up as part of the things that have been resolved. While if we use the catalog, we don't see any additional parts in the dependency result. If you build an application, this difference almost doesn't matter. It becomes interesting if you're building libraries that you also want to publish, where you have to think about which components you publish and if you publish a platform together with the components. That's something we'll also talk about in a different video in detail. The third thing I would like to mention today is dependency locking. So far, we've told Gradle directly which versions we want, but we can also ask Gradle to pick a version for us, for example, the latest stable released version. Instead of defining a fixed version, you use another qualifier in the version declaration. There are a number of different notations supported and options you have. I'll link the documentation from the GitHub page associated with this video. For now, we'll only use the latest release notation, which means for Gradle to look into the repository for the latest released versions and pick that one, which is usually a good choice if you don't really care and just want Gradle to pick the latest and greatest of the dependencies you declare. If you want to use this approach and don't want to add latest release to each of your dependency declarations, you can also use Gradle's dependency substitution mechanisms to add it automatically, which I've done in the example that I've linked from the video. So the problem with dynamic versions in general is that your build is not reproducible. You may run it today and get a good result, and run it tomorrow, a new version has been released, and you encounter some problem. To avoid this, but still make use of dynamic versions, you can use dependency locking. Dependency locking is activated on the configurations that are getting resolved, which is, in the Java world, the runtime class pass and the compile class pass, and also the test runtime and test compile class pass. You can activate the locking in your convention plugin. Once locking is activated, you can tell Gradle explicitly to write a dependencies log file to each of your projects. This file is also committed and pushed to version control. So now if you run your build with locking activated, the log file will be used to provide the versions. Only when you explicitly tell Gradle to regenerate the logs, it will use the dynamic versions again, determine the latest version, and upgrade the logs. This is something a separate CI job could do regularly if you trust that your automatic test will find any issues with the upgrades, or it could be something the team does manually on a regular basis. Because with every dependency update, there is a potential that it breaks something in your production code. Now, after you've seen this video, you might ask yourself which approach you should pick. I find it really hard to give a general answer. All these features are valid in certain use cases from my perspective. What I've mentioned a few times in the video is that it's important how your dependency upgrade process works. Because security issues or other external concerns might force you into upgrading dependencies, even though your production code or your current task doesn't really require it. In any case, I highly recommend to put dependency version in a central place instead of putting them in each build file individually. As always, I've added a link to the GitHub repo containing the samples we looked at to the description of this video. You can go there and play around with the example to get a better feeling for the different approaches. Something that plays also into it is how to handle and resolve dependency conflicts. That's something we'll talk about in the next videos. See you then.